Welcome to Founder Stories here at 1871, Chicago's digital startup hub, where we hear the behind-the-scenes stories of how some of the great companies in our area were built. Tonight, we have Gian Fulgoni, the founder of comScore, the billion-dollar leader in measuring consumer behavior online, and also one of the pioneers behind IRI information resources. John, thanks for being here.
Sure, thank you. Nice to be here.
You have one of the, two of you have been part of two of the legendary stories here in Chicago. Some people may know you through your time at IRI. Of course, comScore is very well known. We see it all the time. And you've got a great story. But a lot of people don't know kind of that you're not a Chicagoan originally. And talk a little bit about where you're from. Share with people a little bit of the early years.
So, I'm not from Chicago. I'm not from the U.S., actually. So I was born and raised in the U.K. in South Wales. My parents were Italian immigrants there. Contrary to what some people believe, not all Italian immigrants came to the U.S. Some of them stopped in the U.K. on the way over. They couldn't afford to get all the way over here. But I was born and raised and went to school and grad school in the U.K. And then, fortunately, I was offered a job by a company still in business and sizable company now called Management Science Associates. And they were based in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And so they had me come over for, it was supposed to be for a year. I was supposed to go through training and then help them open up a London office, go back. And then the first of the 70s recessions hit and everything was put on ice.
So let's go back a little bit if you don't mind. So you were born in South Wales.
Yeah.
And I remember you saying your father was an entrepreneur at a restaurant.
Yep.
And he started, he kind of worked his way to that. Tell a little about that story, because you have entrepreneurship in your blood.
Well, I guess like a lot of immigrants, you know, here in the U.S., maybe around the world, you know, no money, basically, and started making ice cream and selling it off of a barrel that we wheeled around and got a little money together and was able to buy a bicycle. And after a bicycle came a horse and the barrel and the ice cream, and then little bit more money, you open up a little coffee shop, and then finally a restaurant. But this was in South Wales, and the industry, the big industry in South Wales at the time was mining.
Right.
And they were working three shifts a day, so there was always demand for, you know, food and drinks and so forth from the miners. So it was a good but really, really hard business. I think for anybody who thinks about getting into the restaurant business, think long and hard about it, because it is, well, I think the average life of a restaurant in Chicago is 26 months.
Wow.
That'll tell you how difficult it is. But yeah, that's what, so yeah, maybe I think I understood the value of hard work and taking risks, just working, you know, working for what you get. And I think that's certainly something that's kind of guided me in my life.
And so your parents valued education.
Absolutely. They did not want me to go into that same business.
And so what did you, talk about that experience, because UK university system's different, and at the time a lot less people went to university
True.
Than do today.
True. But maybe a lot more graduated. I think the dropout rates here in the States, it's a crazy number, but I think if you look across all universities, I think it's somewhere around 50%. 50% of the people who go to university don't graduate, which is kind of a shocking statistic. Varies by university, obviously. But in the UK at the time, I think still is, it's a three-year program. It wasn't a kind of a continuous assessment program. So if you wanted to change your major, you really had to go back and start all over again. And I majored in physics simply because it was what I happened to be good at in high school, and quickly realized maybe halfway through my first year at university that I had no real competitive advantage at the university level the way I did in high school.
Well, so talk about that a little bit, because I don't want to say I did this or I have, but let's say I have a friend who drank a lot of beer in college. I wasn't necessarily thinking about competitive advantage as much as, so that's an interesting insight. How did you come to the insight that, you know, you wanted to shift gears? Because that's a pretty prescient insight for a teenager to have.
Well, the level of the complexity and the difficulty of the university level was just dramatically different from high school. And I had no idea that was fact until I got into the program. And You know, then I started to not enjoy it, but I concluded it was easier to go on and get my degree in it, and rather than, you know, drop it and start all over again. That would have been just like a wasted year.
So you majored in physics. By the way, I was once told by someone that Albert Einstein was considered by a physicist to be an average mathematician, and I thought that was kind of a dig, and I thought it was kind of funny to throw a dig at Albert Einstein for his average mathematics. So it's obviously a pretty impressive quantitatively driven group. And this is what year?
This was 1966.
So 1966, you then have to ask yourself the question, where's the intersection of competitive advantage,
right,
and sort of interesting future? And so how'd you figure out what that was? Because it was pretty prescient for a young
man. That's a really good question. And by the way, you know, physics is pretty much pure math when you get up to that level, isn't it? You know, no question about it. So I think because of my father being in business and then talking to some other people while I was in undergrad, there was this new thing called marketing that seemed to be emerging, and maybe a lot of people at that time didn't even know what it was. But I had the feeling that if it was really based upon, you know, how you go to the consumer and how you put your product together and market it and sell it and all of that, that you need some data on it. And you know, maybe I was, I think I was right in what I kind of anticipated, but it was pretty clear in the middle 60s that these things called computers were coming along, and there was a massive amount of data being generated, peanuts by today's standards. But I thought that in business, that computers were going to be critical. And so what better thing to do than to go off and get a degree in some kind of business? And there were only two MBA programs in the UK at the time. There was one marketing program. I thought marketing sounded pretty cool. And so that's what I ended up doing. So I got my master's in marketing.
Right. So 51 years ago, you got a master's degree in quantitative marketing. You were a quantitative marketer way before. I mean, people write articles about today like they invented it.
Let's
not leave that. How did you make it sound so obvious, but it obviously was far from the consensus then, let alone even 20 years later.
It wasn't so much quantitative marketing. I mean, there were quantitative courses. There was statistics and data analysis and so on. Again, nothing compared to what it is today, but to somebody with a physics degree, that was pretty simple and straightforward, mm-hmm, to run through, you know, through that quantitative part of it. But it just seemed inevitable to me that computers and data would become central to business. And not just in, you know, maybe back in those days, they were central to finance, certainly.
Yep.
You know, although remember the computers back then were these massive mainframes with punch cards. But not that I necessarily anticipated the shrinking in the size of the computers. I'm not saying I thought that, but I firmly believed that data would and computing would become central to business in functional areas other than finance.
So you come to the U.S. and talk a little bit about this company that brought you to the U.S. and why that interested you.
Well, that was, it was just a really, really interesting company. So it was started in Pittsburgh by one of the first marketing science professors coming out of Carnegie Mellon, who built a lot of the early models of consumer behavior based on the databases that were available back then. But the concept of this company was interesting because they weren't in the business of creating the data themselves. They were in the business of analyzing any data that a client might have. So they might take the client's shipment data, the bi-monthly sales data, relate it to the advertising spending and the promotion spending, and build basically regression models predicting what the impact was of the various elements of the marketing plan. And it was fantastic for me because it allowed me to learn all of the basics of data. I could see the way that things were progressing and the way that computers were changing and the type of data that was changing.
When you first came over, you thought it was for a year.
I thought it was for a year.
And so what happened?
I discovered that I liked heating. I liked central heating. I liked I liked having a telephone. I mean, really, all of the things that Americans, we take for granted, just didn't exist in most other countries, if not all other countries. So I liked the lifestyle. I could just see it was exciting. Marketing was taking off. By this time in the 70s. And the last thing I wanted to do was to go back. And fortunately, they asked me to stay, and I stayed.
So you're in this consultancy. You're in Pittsburgh.
Yep.
It's not a product business, and it's not Chicago. So how do you make the connection from there to this? To what became IRI?
Oh, well, the IRI story was interesting.
Talk about the bridge between the two.
Yeah, so there was a gentleman by the name of John Malik, who still is here in Chicago, who had worked at MSA. He had worked out of the Chicago office. And at one point, I was promoted to run the Chicago office. He had left, and he was off dreaming up what became IRI. And so I got a call from him in December of 1980, or sometime in 1980, and he said, I just started this company called IRI. How would you like to come over and be president?
What was his pitch? What was his vision when he started it?
Oh, it was at that time. It was what the product was. It was unbelievable to me at that time, and maybe even today, looking back, 35 years ago. So what they had done. In 1979, when they started the company, he and two other guys.
If you don't mind, just a second. This is one of the most interesting product market fit stories. Before you tell the how, because I think the how is fascinating, just explain what the chicken egg problem they had to solve. Because
So the challenge was, how do you measure consumer behavior quickly and in a granular manner, in a timely manner, and how do you understand the impact that television advertising and the other elements of the marketing mix are having on that behavior. So the challenge was measuring the behavior and then figuring out the design of a real-world experimental design, if you will, that would allow one to change variables in a controlled manner and figure out the impact on sales.
Let me just set this up because I think it's really interesting. So the problem is you have to know what people are watching. You want to control what they're watching.
Correct.
And then you want to know what they buy.
Correct.
And, of course, it's fairly hard to get people to say, take over my TV and do these things. So you found a piggyback technology here to piggyback on. It was a cable box, right?
It was the cable box, correct.
So talk about that insight, because you had an interesting chicken-egg problem, which is it's too much work for people to do if you didn't make it easy. So talk about how you guys cracked the code on that.
So Jerry Eskin, the gentleman, Dr. Jerry Eskin, passed away now, was a brilliant guy. He taught at Stanford, taught at the University of Iowa. And apparently the idea came to him when he was in a hotel and watching video on demand movies. And he realized that the cable box was what was changing the channel that the television set was tuned to. Well, then it ought to be pretty straightforward to come up with a box that allows IRI to change the channel that any set is tuned to, that the box is attached to. And if you had control of the channels on the cable system, you could switch the reception of that box and that television set from channel A to channel B when the ad break comes on. And that was what it was.
So you basically substituted your own commercials.
Correct.
Your test commercials.
Correct.
For what they would have normally watched.
Right. So basically we had to have the cooperation of the cable system. So at the head end of the cable system, we'd have our facility is probably a little small trailer, and we were sending at the appropriate time, the operator there would send the substitute television commercial down a channel that we had exclusive access to, okay? And also from that head end, they control what channel each of the boxes was tuned to. So when an ad break came on, you simply changed over a half of the TVs to the channel where the substitute ad was coming down. And so all of a sudden, you had a whole set of households that were seeing commercial A and a whole set of households that were seeing commercial B. So that was the solution for, it was targetable, you know, it's targetable television advertising, which still hasn't really become, if you think about it, it's on a one-to-one basis, targetable addressable TV, it's called addressable TV, still doesn't exist beyond, I think it's 40 million households in the US that can get it today. And the ad inventory that's available is really, really limited. So that was the, we were able to do, I think, we could do three alternative commercials, or you could do weight tests. You could run a commercial, you know, 10 times a day to one group of homes, once a day to another group of homes, right? So that was the delivery mechanism. You could select the households so that they were balanced, mm-hmm. just like you might.
Where were they? Well,
another good question. So one was in Marion, Indiana, which is just, you know, down the road, so to speak, and the other is in Pittsfield, Massachusetts, all right? And those places were selected because they were thought to be somewhat representative demographically. And so you could get people, you could select people to get the right demos to reflect, you know, either a big region or the U.S. But the other reason that we picked those cities is that we had to take care of the sales tracking piece. And the solution there was the UPC scanner, the point of sale scanner.
So talk about it for a second. So back in 1979, not a lot of companies had the kind of scanners we're used to in stores
today. Maybe 5% of the stores, something like that.
So how do you get, and they're pretty expensive, I would imagine, back then.
$150,000 per store back then.
Wow.
So the solution was to get some money and buy a scanning system for each store. But you couldn't do it in a massive city. You had to do it in a smaller city. So there were maybe 10 supermarkets in Marion and maybe 10 in Pittsfield. And so the idea was we bought the scanning system for each store, but in return, we got exclusive access to the data and the agreement of the retailer that they would take new products that we wanted to evaluate.
So but talk about that, because I think a lot of times founders get there and they say, well, I'll give it to them. But they can give it to people. It's the old bring a horse to water, can't make them drink. You give it to them, but you also have to get them to adopt it, right? You need to get the people to sort of change it. So sure. Talk about how you made it attractive. What about value prop made it something that they were willing to change? Yeah.
So that was
tested for you.
Fortunately, that wasn't something that we had to do. So you might hear today, you'd hear the benefits of scanning, POS scanning, especially in your supermarkets, mass merchandise. I mean, these scanners are everywhere. You might hear the benefit being what at the time was called the soft benefit, the informational benefits, mm-hmm. okay? That wasn't what persuaded these retailers to put these things in. It was the hard benefits, because before the scanners, a retailer would have to have somebody or multiple people price mark every individual item with a price, so that when you got to the front end of the store and you're checking out the cashier, you knew what the price for the product was. And in a store that's carrying 20,000 items, and those prices on a lot of them are changing weekly, that's a relatively massive
right.
cost for the retailer.
And I imagine there's errors and fraud.
Plus the cost of the labor is huge.
Right.
And so scanning, what really got the retailers willing to do the scanning was they could eliminate the price marking. It was a hard benefit. They didn't have to put up the cash for the scanner. And all they needed to do was to maintain what still today is called a price file. Every UPC code and the price for that week. The consumer gets to the front end of the store, the product is scanned, and boom, you got the data. So then we persuaded consumers to show an ID card. The consumers who had the box on their television set also showed a card when they checked out of the front end of the store. And then we had it, because we knew what people who got commercial A were buying compared to what people who got commercial B, or heavy spending versus light spending, or all kinds of different variables. And we could do it in a granular manner, right? You measure it by individual SKU. You can measure the data by day if you wanted. And it was a home run. I mean, it required capital, but not crazy amounts of capital. But it was really, it just caught the consumer packaged goods industry by surprise, and it wasn't inexpensive to run tests. And I think we were charging maybe $200,000 for an ad test on one product. So, but they were willing to pay it because they...
Talk about the impact, because you saw the chicken egg, and now what's the impact like when you first bring the marketing science to this area?
Well, it was revolutionary. I mean, it was somebody called, I mean, it was an article written, in, I don't know, in Forbes or Business Week or whatever, called it a marketing man's dream. And, you know, in a sense it was, because it allowed you to really precisely measure the impact of your television spending. And it was just sexy. I mean, just the whole design of the system was really really appealing. So the business took off, and I think we grew it. I think it went 2 million in revenue, 6 million, 12 million, 24 million, and we were running at margins probably somewhere around 30% pre-tax margin. So very profitable. We were able to take the company public. And
so what were the challenges in scaling that fast? I mean, that's really incredible growth.
Probably the normal ones that you have today. And like, how can you get the right people, hire them fast enough? How do you maintain control? Because we were opening up other markets. By the time we got to the middle 80s, we had, I think, six of these markets running, and we were off doing other things with the data. So it was, I think that, I'm not sure that the challenges have changed, you know, that much. I mean, maybe one, right? The competitive technology wasn't changing at anywhere near the rate of change that it is today. And so you don't have to wake up every morning thinking you might be out of business. It was relatively stable. But, you know, the challenge of growing the revenue at that, you know, at that rate was still there. And I'd say it was more just maintaining control, just making sure that, you know, the quality was there and things weren't getting messed up, and making sure you had the right people.
So you said something interesting when we talked before, which is, you know, you were part of the early marketing science, bringing data and quantitative analysis and A-B testing and all to the advertising world. And I asked you what one of the most underappreciated things you thought, you know, was anything lost along the way. And your answer surprised me. You said creative. Talk about why you think creative in this whole revolution, because now what you pioneered has become a revolution. But
yeah, that's a good question. I said to Howard when he was giving me a tour of the facility tonight, and he took me through the ad tech part, and I said, how come you don't have comScore here? You know, I think we might be able to help in terms of an understanding of what's going on with ad tech in digital. But I believe personally that back in the 80s, creative was valued much, much more than it is today. I think today it seems to have shifted to media and technology, and creative has become secondary to it, right? I mean, look at the way that advertising agencies split up 15 years ago or so, right? Into media and creative, you know, and somebody sarcastically said, well, agencies outsourced creative, right? Derogatory way of describing it, but they knew the money was gonna be made from the agency's perspective in the media, in the buying, right? The buying of the media, and then what they priced that at the client. That maybe is coming back to haunt the industry today with, you know, this transparency issue that's really becoming a problem. But I remember, I'll give you one, maybe this was the example I gave you when we chatted. All right? So we were running a test for Coca-Cola. Right? Now, Coca-Cola spends a lot of money advertising what today is maybe Coke Classic. Back then, it was pretty much the only Coca-Cola product. All right? And they said to us, we'd like to see if we can move the needle, and we want to spend in your experimental city six times the amount of advertising we would normally spend. Okay, we could do it. So we were running these ads, you know, six times on one group of homes and normal level on the other group of homes. And I looked, and I was having to go down to Coca-Cola and explain the results. And I looked at the stuff, and there was no change. There's no difference between the two groups. And so six times the spending, which was a lot of money, was generating no lift in sales. I'm thinking, oh, God, something must have gone wrong here, and I don't know what it is, and now I'm going to get hammered when I went down to Coca-Cola. I go down there, present the results, and I'm waiting for the explosion. And the head of research looks at me, and he goes, okay. And I said to him, so you're not surprised? He goes, no, why would I be surprised? Six times zero is still zero. That was a You know, man, that's what it is. The creative they were using was just not, you know, just not valuable. And it just shows you the importance of creative. I mean, there's been a lot of work done since then that shows that for a typical television campaign, the creative generates 70% of the variance in the sales of the brand, right? It's that important. But it's easy to get lost, I think, in today's age, certainly in today's age of technology, and it becomes secondary. So I think what might happen going forward, I wouldn't be surprised if, just like mercury coagulates, if the media and the creative stuff doesn't come back together more tightly than it is. That said, I will say that in this digital age where creativity is really coming into play, not so much in terms of what you say in the TV commercial and, you know, just what the campaign itself is, but where there is real creativity happening is how you combine digital with television and all of the other things that technology allows you to do, especially leveraging social media. There are some amazing, amazing things that are being done, very, very powerful marketing campaigns being put together. That might be where creativity is today.
Interesting. So you're at IRI, you have a great success, the company's going well. Talk a little bit about, you know, where the idea for comScore came about, and because I think it came about earlier than people understand, the genesis story, if you will.
Well, we started, my partner and I, who was my president when I was CEO of IRI, he and I started in 99, but we were thinking about it, I believe, it's the beginning of 99. But what had happened in the several years before that at IRI is that we had gone off, by then scanning was in 80% of the stores, and you could assemble very very large networks of scanners. You wouldn't buy the scanners for the retailer, but you pay them for the data. And you could track what was happening by week, by day, by SKU, understand what was driving it. And it's interesting because before that, before scanning, the way that a Procter & Gamble or a Unilever would know what they were selling to consumers is that they would use the AC Nielsen company and a manual audit. So literally until the middle 80s, there were like 5,000 people going to retail stores and counting how many boxes were on the shelf and then going into the back room and looking at the invoices and what had been shipped for the warehouse. And it was 6 data points a year. So you get a data point every, you know, every 2 months. Slow, not a lot of granularity on it, and scanning completely replaced it. So at IRI, we had gone national with the system, and then we went into Europe, and it became a very, very expensive proposition to expand as fast as we did. Maybe that was another lesson that we didn't need to do it as fast as we did. But we learned we knew how to build a company. We knew how to build a big database company. We knew, you know, the ins and outs of running it, you know, from a business perspective. So when the internet came along, the challenge was clear that if you wanted to build an information service, you needed to count how many people were going to a website, because that's needed for media planning. You need to know the demographics and how many people, but you also need to know what was bought. And we felt that we knew how to assemble a business like that. Not that we necessarily knew when we started the technology, we assumed that we'd be able to figure it out, which we did. But the genesis of comScore was really in the experience we had at with IRI.
So the early, you left IRI, talk about how that early startup kind of took place.
So Majid, this gentleman's name, Majid Abraham, he's now teaching at Stanford, and I decided we want to do it, had to raise money, just like people have to do today.
Well, not quite like people do today. You had already built IRI and, you know.
Well, yeah, I meant you had the step of raising money. Maybe what was different is that we didn't go out and try to build the technology. This is what we didn't have to do. We didn't have to go out, build the technology, and then show the technology and say, well, will you fund the growth of this? You know, we had the credibility to be able to go to Excel in California and Flatiron in New York and say, here's what we're going to build, right? And, you know, this is what we need in terms of capital. I think we raised $10 million, and Dan Malvin, who's sitting right down here at the front, who's now starting his own fund, was one of the key people in us that we met with. So it was easy to raise the money, you know, again, because of the experience that we've had, and off we went. Then the challenge was really building the technology once we had the money.
What made it hardest back then? Because the web's obviously evolved a lot in the last 15 years or so.
So you had to have, first of all, the retailers weren't going to give you the data. You know, to this day, they don't share their sales data. So we had to have...
Did you expect that going in, they wouldn't share it?
No, we knew that wouldn't happen. So we had to have, the idea was, we're going to recruit a massive panel of people who let us put our software on their desktops. There was no mobile devices then. And that's going to allow us to see where they go. And then we're going to somehow figure out how to, with permission, to put ourselves in the middle of that secure session so that we can see what was bought, what's being paid, how, what the shipment method was, et cetera. So we had to build the software for the data capture, and then we had to figure out how are we going to get people to let us do this. You can't pay them money, you know, you can never scale it. And so that's when Rashid came up with this idea. It was pretty interesting. So we knew that we had to route the user's machine through our servers to the website to capture the data, all right? So we were in a meeting with a potential client or whatever describing this, and the guy goes, well, aren't you going to slow the connection down if you route it that way? And this was before broadband, right? You know, so people were on 50K modems or, you know, probably using U.S. robotics modems, you know, back then. So what happened is that when the guy said, you're going to slow the connection down with all this routing, I could see Majid react as if a lightning bolt had hit him, and he didn't say anything. So I figured he came up with an idea. We walked out of the meeting, and he grabs a hold of me. He goes, it's not going to slow down. We're going to speed it up. And what he came up with was the idea of some new compression technology and some other stuff he did. So we made a 50K modem look like it was a 90K modem. We didn't move it to, you know, broadband. But at that point in time, it was really an attractive proposition, especially if it was free. And so we said to people, that's what we'll give you if you let us put our software on your machine and you give us permission to measure everything.
That was their hard benefit, like you had with the IRI.
Exactly. So that was it. And then, you know, we figured out the database warehousing and the data processing analysis, the weighting, all of that other stuff was much, much easier. And that was it.
And you raised 5 rounds at?
We did. We did. I think it was something like $80 million. And how much? 90 million dollars.
Well, so now we rarely get someone who was in the room. So tell me the story of how the two of you met.
He was in every round. I mean, every round we did.
So tell the story of how you met. Tell this as an, you know.
So.
And the role he played. That's great.
So this is Dan Malvin. So we.
Who was Dan with at the time?
Dan was with Flatiron. So we wanted a West Coast VC and we wanted an East Coast VC because we figured they'd have contacts in different, you know, parts of the, you know, the media world in New York and all of the, you know, the tech world on the West Coast. So we went up, we were introduced, got an introduction, went up and made the pitch and got the first $10 million, all right? And this was in 99. Now remember, what subsequently happened is the implosion of the internet and 9/11, all right? And so, here we were. We weren't cash flow positive yet, but our expenses were going like this, and yeah, you know, our revenue line was kind of building, but then all of a sudden, when you know, the internet imploded and 9/11 happened, the revenue line just started to flatten or even go down, right? Because everything ground to a halt. So our cash burn increased. And we had to go and raise more money. And so we went back to the original investors along with other, you know, I think it's still the same today. On the next round, your existing investors won't lead it because they'll tell you that they can't set a price on the deal and they need an outside third-party objective estimate. All right, fine. So every round we did, we had to get a new investor. And Dan and Flatiron came in on every round, as did Excel. And then we did the last round, interestingly, with was led by Ken Griffin and Citadel here in Chicago.
That's got to be unusual. They didn't do it. I didn't know they did that kind of investing.
He hadn't. I think it was the first deal he'd done. And I think Dan introduced me to him. It plays a role in this story. So Dan and we were doing work with the data that we still do, where we were trying to give kind of signals from the data of what was likely to happen to a public equity, right? We could estimate what Amazon sales might be. We could try to estimate what the unemployment rate might be, because you're seeing both the supply and demand side of the advertising for jobs. And, you know, and these models, you know, back then were working pretty well. So Ken looked at the deal and said, I like the deal and I like the data and I want to make sure that, you know, that if I'm going to make an investment, that I also get the data. And we put a really nice nice deal together with him, and he was very supportive. That was the last round. But I mentioned that implosion of the internet and the 2000 and the 9/11 thing, because it probably caused us to have to raise another $30 million more than we had expected. Hmm. And so out of the 90, we maybe could have gotten by with 60, if not for that. And, you know, we were fortunate that we had VCs who believed in what we were building and were willing to continue to invest, because at that point in time, a lot of companies went out of business, right? As we all well know, some of our clients, in fact, pets.com was our first client.
Oh, wow. You know, well, that hurt a lot of people. I know Akamai, a friend of mine, Paul Sagan, ran Akamai after, because the founder had died in 9/11, and he said the problem was a perfect storm, because they had so many internet company clients. Right. As they went bankrupt, their revenue went.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, there's a little shakeout happening now in the ad tech world. You know, nowhere near the magnitude of that, but there are some smaller companies that are going out of business as, you know, the industry consolidates a little here in the sector.
So we'll get to the questions in just a moment. One last question before we do. Questions from the audience. You said something interesting about scaling that I thought was interesting, and it would be great to share. You talked about how, and maybe you can give some context behind this for the audience. You said, you know, when you're in the early startup stage, you need heroes, and when you get to a certain stage, you need managers. And if you can just talk about how a lot of people say, I just want to get great people, I want to get a great team, but what is great for the time is different, and you really, that's one of the lessons I think you talked about was valuable and scary.
Yeah, I think I've been through it twice, you know, and it's good to have gone through it, because it means your company's gotten to a certain size. But I do think individual brilliance when you're starting the business is obviously critical, and I think it's true across different functional areas. And one of the things I always say to people is make sure that you got the best that you can get, you know, in each of the areas, you know, whether it's technology, the CEO, et cetera, operations, et cetera. But what happens is, I think once you're successful and the business has grown, the trains have got to run on time. Mm-hmm. And the people who have the skills to be those individually brilliant people are not necessarily the people who make good managers. And I don't know if it's that they get bored with it. That might be it. I mean, the skills you need to manage something and worry about the nitty-gritty details every minute of the day is very different than if you are looking for that brilliant breakthrough idea. Very, very different. And I find, in my experience at least, I found very, very few people who can wear both hats. And so as the company scales, you have to start changing the mix of people. Not that you don't need still the creative people, the brilliant software engineers. You still need all of those. But you also have to start infusing the company.
And how do you, as the CEO, be effective in both contexts? And how do you evolve from one to the other?
You have to make sure that you bring in those people. You know, and you have to, at least again in my experience, you struggle with the people who were there when you started the company. Are they going to not like the fact that you're bringing in somebody now who's a really top-notch manager, and maybe they're not reporting to that person? You've got to deal with all of that, you know, that human challenge. So you got to bring the people in, but then you got to make, I think you have to, at least what I do, you make them heroes. Mm-hmm. You make them heroes every bit as much as the people who are the individual, maybe brilliant contributors. You make them heroes. You make them heroes publicly. And you can always find a position for the individually brilliant people, but if they aren't good managers and they bridle at not having all those people report into them, you have a problem. And I think it's really, really important to put people in places where they are doing what they're really good at, and that you, but you have to get around the human, the human ego issues, to do that.
Let me take a couple questions from the audience. Voting always helps. How do you pick a mentor is one of the questions here. How do you pick a mentor?
How do you pick one? I think I was fortunate in, I learned the two people who probably had the three people who had the biggest influence on me, for me, were not people I necessarily picked. I mean, first was the guy who owned the company that I went to work for when I first came to the States. I learned a ton about data and analysis from him. And then John Malik, who I think is a brilliant creative guy and a brilliant businessman. I learned a lot about running a business from him. And then third would be Majid. So I was fortunate in that I didn't have to look outside for a mentor, but I would say, maybe a direct answer to the question, I think you just got to really try to look for somebody who has the knowledge and the skills in areas that you don't have. That's the way I, personally think about things, and it just goes back to, do you have a competitive advantage? You have to, because if you don't, I don't think you're likely to succeed in today's ultra-competitive world. I say this to kids when I'm talking to them in school and so on, is do a brutal assessment. Do an honest, brutal assessment of what your skills and your weaknesses are, all right? And then pick a mentor try to find a mentor that will fill in the blanks that you've got. But then on top of it, make sure that you use that information to decide what you're going to do, right? You got to do something you love. I think that's a necessity, something you love. But you've got to be in an area where if you want to be really successful in an area where you think you have a competitive advantage.
That's great advice. Great advice. Next question is, what mistake did you make in the first year of the business that you wish you could change?
So here's a mistake. When you hire quickly and you don't pay enough attention and check out the person is a big, it just has a leverage impact.
There's always that pressure to say, well, we got to hire someone. It's better to have someone than not have someone. And people cut corners. It's great.
Especially today with the time pressure. And, we keep hearing stories about how you have to move at the speed of light and this and that and the other. Well, think about this. If I hire somebody who's 80% of what I want, right? And that person then hires somebody who's 80% of what they want. Before you know it, you are operating at 50% inefficiency. And it's a multiplicative negative factor. Now, the only way you can get around that was taking more time. But, you then are in the challenge of today's businesses where you often don't have the time. But I think if you don't take the time, you could end up with just a problem because it just dilutes all of the subsequent hiring that you do.
That's right. It's great advice. Most important thing to keep in mind when starting a business, if you had to give sort of general advice?
Yeah. I would say you have to really have a good feel for whether somebody is going to buy what you make or not. And that's just not always evident.
Right.
Okay. And here's why you can go out and do all the research you want and ask people, will you buy this? I'm going to bring you this. Will you buy it? Right. And you've got to be really careful because if it's a real breakthrough product, I don't think humans can necessarily anticipate whether or not they're going to buy that
right.
when it comes along. The movie business is a great example, right? I often get people say to me, well, with all of the technical market research that's possible today, why are so many movies a bust? You know, is it that they're not doing the research? No, it's not that they're not doing the research. They're doing the research, but the consumers that they're asking about it can't assimilate that new concept. And most movies are a new concept.
Right.
And it's, you know, I'll give you another example, right? If you had said to people at the time when liquid detergents for washing machines first came along, you said to them, would you buy this? Most of the people would say no, because they had no idea. They just couldn't grasp the concept.
Right.
And so it's difficult to nail it, but I think if you don't have a good feel, you know, you...
Well, and one of the tricks, you can be wrong. You can like it and not represent your market, but I think the other one that gets people is being really, really early is the same thing as being wrong, because you're going to run out of money before the market
gets. Yeah, I mean, you know, it's the first... Being early is sometimes the first chance to be wrong at something, right? And that's maybe the trickiest part of all is, you know, this is why I just don't think that there's a hard and fast rule for how, you know, for how to do it. I mean, maybe that's where the brilliant entrepreneurs come in. Mm-hmm. Maybe there's an element of luck in it, you know?
Well, this is interesting. This is a lot of what the series on product market fit we're doing from some of the founders, and it's interesting. Because I find the best founders are really have one of two things. Either they're scratching their own itch in such a way that they really understand the market because they are represent that market really well. Or they have such a rigorous discipline, like, you know, Jay Schakowat from Fieldglass or Brett Hurt, who's at Data.World now, who did a couple of great companies.
Bizarre Voice
and Core Metrics. You know, he has a discipline where he goes and actually does mock-ups, and he shows them to people and then iterates on what he learns, and he doesn't build a line of code until he has a handshake customer. And, you know, I think the ones who are most successful have one of those two things. They either understand that market so well, like you did a comScore because of IRI.
Correct. That's it.
Or they have this rigorous discipline. But if you don't have one of those two, it's pretty hard to hit.
Yeah, I mean, it does give you, it gives you the confidence that when you've got at least one paying customer, it doesn't guarantee you that what you've just built for that customer is what other people will want. That's another mistake I've learned along the way. And at comScore, we've been successful and unsuccessful at that. We've built a variety of our products where a client asked us to do something like, we track search queries. Yahoo was the first one who said, can you track that? Yeah, we think we can. We went off and built it and found that a whole bunch of people wanted to buy it. But we've also built things. We found that... But
what have you learned about how to take that customer who comes to you with an idea and figure out, is that something that there's...
It's not easy. I mean, I'm not sure there's a really hard and fast rule for it. You know, the other thing I know I've said is, and this is a little provocative, is... I think it's rare that you'll get the idea for a breakthrough product from talking to a customer who's already buying in that market. Okay, and that Henry Ford story, I'm sure everybody's heard, you know, when he was asked, where did you get the idea for the Model T? Customers must have told you. And he goes, you know, if I had listened to my customers, I would have built a very, very, very fast horse. Mm-hmm. You know, right? It's just, this is the tricky part of it. And, I don't think there's a formula for the solution here, and maybe that's where the uncertainty comes in.
That's a great insight. We have one big vote getter, and then the final two questions. If you could invest in one new startup in Chicago, if you feel like you have the knowledge to do this, what would it be? Feel free to decline if you want. I won't put you in a bad spot, but it was top of the list.
God, I saw a bunch of them today with Howard. Can I just give you one that I did?
Sure.
So Upshow, which you'll see their screen here, which is a really cool application of social media to venues, whether the venues are bars or restaurants or whatever. It's pretty cool. I mean, that was my most recent investment.
And do you do a lot of angel investing?
Yeah, I've done a fair amount. Yeah, although as I get older, somebody said to David Ogilvy, the advertising guy, so what do you think about the future? And he said, well, you know, you have to understand, I have a diminishing interest in the future. And so you have to, you got to be careful about it.
So we always end these with two questions that I find really interesting. The first is there something from your experience that you've done that you say, boy, I did this, it seemed like a good idea at the time, yeah, but I'd never do that again?
I'll give you another provocative one. And this is going to fly in the face of what you hear. You've heard that the customer is always right. Customer is always right for themselves. Okay? Customer doesn't mean that what customer is saying that you should do is right for you. I had the example with IRI. We were really successful in the US, and customers said, this scanning stuff is fantastic. Why don't you go and take it over to Europe where it doesn't, nobody's built out these systems yet. It's still all manual audits. And so we put together the business plan and went off and did it. And the mistake we made is that half of the clients weren't telling us to do it because they wanted to buy it from us. They wanted us to do it to cause the competition to move or to get the competition to drop their prices by 30%. Hmm. And so the entire business plan that we built assumed probably twice as much revenue as actually unfolded.
Wow.
And that was a real, real lesson. I mean, you just, you know, and it's a provocative thing to say, right? But you just got to be careful because, you know, customers are negotiating for themselves when all is said and done. And you know, the partner thing, I don't know, that partner thing, I keep hearing that term. And you just got to make sure that the terms of the partnership are what makes sense for you and not just what makes sense, you know, for the client. And I learned that one the hard way.
Interesting. The last one we always ask is, you know, is there something you feel like you got right that said, boy, that was critical. I would always do that again. It's just a key
okay.
Sort of thing.
So that's another pet peeve of mine. So I think one has to be very, very careful about giving advice. So here I am giving advice. I'm saying being very careful about it. All right. I think advice has to be taken in context. And if you take it out of context, you can really be led astray. You know, and there are examples in life of it, right? I mean, sayings. Out of sight, out of mind. Absence makes the heart grow fonder. Well, wait a second. Those are complete opposites that have come out of people's life history, right? So I think that whenever one gets advice or gives advice, one should always kind of really understand the context in which it's taken from and then the context in which it's given, because it's not always right.
Right. Well, it's appropriate that a physicist goes back to first principles when taking advice. There's been a lot of great insight tonight, Jan. Thank you so much.
Sure, you're welcome. Thanks a lot. Thank you.